This evening on The Rock Newman Show, what do the Capitals, Wizards, Mystics, and Verizon Center have in common? Ted Leonsis as the owner. He is also an Emmy Award-winning film producer and an avid philanthropist. Modern-day Renaissance man, Ted Leonsis is in the house to tell us what else is on the horizon that's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Sports and entertainment mogul, film producer, and digital entrepreneur, and just recently, Ted Leonsis took over as chairman of DC Cap, the nonprofit educational program that helps DC kids get into college. This evening, he takes time out of his busy schedule to tell us what motivates him to do it all. Welcome, thank you so much for coming on today.
Thanks for the invite.
Man, you're the busiest man, hardest working man in show business, in sports and entertainment, in the entrepreneurial world, and you took time to come see us, and we are thankful and grateful.
Well, I appreciate it. I love coming here to Howard University too. It's right up the street from Verizon Center, and I just feel like this community is really, really important to the city, and what you're doing here on campus is fantastic.
Ted, I had been trying to get you for a while through your people, and I saw a headline, and it said Leonsis to take over from Donald Graham, DC Caps, and that my head snapped when I saw that. I actually wasn't familiar with the DC Caps program, and so I'll let my audience know I sent you an email and told you that I had seen that, and I got a favorable response shortly thereafter. Tell us, first of all, as we sit here on Howard University's college campus, tell us about this CAPS program, what it does, and what drew you to it.
Well, at the heart of hope for generations is getting educated, and we know that there's a direct correlation between career success and graduating from college. Yeah. And here we are in Washington, D.C., most powerful, one of the wealthiest communities in the country, and we all have a lot of work to do still to create a culture of first-generation students going to college. And I have deep empathy for that. My mom and dad didn't go to college. I was the first one to go to college in my family, and I've seen the power of education. Mm-hmm. And so Don Graham, his family, and Don long-term with the Washington Post, he saw this need, and the way he attacked the need was to say, let's create a giving platform where we will pay for embedding college guidance counselors into many of the schools in the city to help create a culture on what classes to take, how to apply to college, how to write your essays, how to take AP classes and the like. And then we'll offer scholarship as well as help students and families package up scholarships from other organizations. And this community and city has a lot of scholarship organizations. And so we're trying to remove all of the impediments there are for first generation college attending students to want to go to school. And there's a lot that they have to overcome. Mm-hmm. The average graduation rate here from college, the time it takes is 6 years. Well, that adds to expense. There's a lot of the students are transferring to community colleges from four-year colleges and then going back. Mm-hmm. And so we're trying to create systems that get the students into the college that they desire, have them graduate, then have them come back into this great city, get good paying jobs, contribute to the tax base, get married, have children here, then have their children be the next generation of college going class. And I think it's bedrock and fundamental to the success of the community.
So what will be your responsibility now as the chairman of that organization?
Well, they have such a good organization. So many of these organizations are in place. I think right now, reimagining what the higher calling of the programs are and making sure that what we're doing today is still relevant than when these programs were started a decade ago. Another big part of it is raising money, donating money, being able to continue to help these students to get in the schools and stay in the schools, and also providing research and what's called big data or rich data around what is the problem. There's been some remarkable studies on the issue around middle class, upper class, and are less economically fortunate, and what happens from kindergarten on, and that how important the summer time becomes to students. And it's interesting, if you're born into a middle class household and that summer of kindergarten, if someone is reading to you during that summer versus you don't have that opportunity, you fall behind in kindergarten 3 to 6 months from your competitor, if you will. Yeah. And then first grade, if you have that same experience. And the economic strata on education, sometimes by the time you're in the sixth or seventh grade, you have fallen a full 2 or 3 years behind a fellow student.
Yeah.
And so when some of these students are graduating and being prepared for college, they're functioning at a ninth grade level instead of at a 12th grade level. So then when they go to college, they feel that they're behind, they don't do well in college, they drop out. And so we're trying to look now at the holistic journey through education by economic strata, just to make sure that everyone has a level playing field and that everyone can have equal footing to
go forward. So this particular program, when they talk about, when people hear about scholarships, they think about, okay, somebody in their junior or senior year is getting prepared to go to college. So you're talking about, so is this program actually addressing K through 12?
No, DCCAP specifically is aimed at making sure that there's a college-going culture in selected high schools and that we embed college counselors. Uh-huh. Most of the high schools in D.C. will have counselors, guidance counselors, but not college-going counselors. Mm-hmm. Many private schools, many of the more affluent communities will have both, so we wanted to try to level that playing field. And then we do offer scholarship, and it's kind of the last part of the scholarship journey. There's D.C. TAG, which our Congresswoman Eleanor Norton was just a goddess to make sure that students in Washington, D.C. could be treated like someone from Virginia and Maryland. They could go to University of Maryland and University of Virginia as an in-state student. And so there's this tapestry of charities around Washington, D.C., and some of us are trying to work to make sure that they're integrated systemically to get that whole person, that entire journey. You know, it could come down to the food that you're fed in school. It could be making sure that during the summer that you have jobs or that you can go to school, summer school. And I think that that's really what many of us are focused on. How do we improve the graduation rates and then the amount of students that are going from high school directly to college and then can finish college in 4 years?
Ted, oftentimes when people think of the term and the position and the people who wear the title mogul, they don't think of this kind of commitment to a community. Where does yours come from?
Well, I don't think of myself as a mogul. I do think that it came from my parents. My dad was a waiter He didn't finish high school. My mom was a secretary. She didn't go to college. But they volunteered a lot. They couldn't give money, so they gave time. My mom was always the one cooking at the bake sales. I remember being very, very young and my dad walking me up and down the street as we raised money for the Jerry Lewis telethons.
Okay.
And just from an early age, they role modeled that giving back was important. And I do think, especially here in Washington, D.C., where we have this this dichotomy more pronounced than any other place in America. Mm-hmm. And we see it within blocks of the White House or the Capitol building or Verizon Center that you can have by an avenue separating haves and have-nots.
Yes.
And so we should be the exemplar community, I think, for our country. And I think that many people, I mean, we're not alone in this. It's unacceptable that we have these two Washingtons. Or it's actually, I'll say three Washingtons. Mm-hmm. It's federal Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
There's the new Washington, the city that's just booming and cultural and arts and sports and everyone is moving in from the suburbs back to Washington. Mm-hmm. And then we have some communities that have been neglected and they shouldn't be. And so we're all doing our best to embrace and provide a level playing field.
Are you encouraged by the support or frustrated by the lack thereof?
Depends on the day. As I said, I just left a DC College Success Board meeting. The Gates Foundation has been incredibly generous and has donated a lot of money, and there's no reason that a student, especially from Ward 7 and Ward 8, mm-hmm. shouldn't be well regarded in their experience of applying and going to college and graduating from college. And we've all spent a lot of time, effort, money, and we're moving the needle mm-hmm. incrementally, mm-hmm. but not as much as you would think. And a lot of it comes to a whole series of economic issues.
Yeah.
And so where sometimes it gets overwhelming is, well, it's not just about the school system or the culture of going to college or the availability of scholarship. Mm-hmm. If a young man or woman's mother and father have been laid off or don't have a job, that drives a lot of decision.
Right.
If there's illness in the family, that drives.
Yeah.
If there's been incarceration of family members, and so what I'm finding, and it's not daunting, but it's that everything is mm-hmm. interconnected.
Yes.
Students graduate and have too much debt, mm-hmm. And or they graduate, but the jobs here are for STEM, in science and technology and research and math fields. And so we put someone in to help someone to get into school, and they didn't study mm-hmm. the right things. And then they graduate, and they can't get jobs. And mm-hmm. there's frustration, and maybe they have some student debt. And so we're trying to take a holistic approach. And it is daunting, but we got to try.
This begs a question. As a country and as a two-party, basically, political system, 50-plus years ago, Martin Luther King talked about a war on poverty. Has this country and its political leaders done enough to address poverty?
I think many of the programs are well-intentioned, and I do think that it's a important platform for people who've been around for a long time, but the honest appraisal is no, not as much. Mm-hmm. I think a big part of it is that the communities aren't organized enough. They should be more organized, that their voices should be heard louder and clearer on the kinds of programs that would be helpful. Mm-hmm. I think that perhaps there are some programs that have been put in place that have served their usefulness and that they can be reimagined. You know, I made mention of where are the jobs, right? Yeah. You always want to follow the money.
Yeah.
And so if science and technology is where the jobs are, mm-hmm. that if we're not repurposing educational spending and training there and making sure that women, making sure that minorities are being exposed early on to these subjects and this technology, well, they'll not have the opportunity to get the high-paying jobs. Mm-hmm. And so technology is changing so quickly. The good news is that if every 2 or 3 years there's a whole new generation of technology and that speed of change happens so fast, you can catch up very quickly, uh-huh. right? You can take a younger generation and get them acclimated to technology very, very quickly. And you can make investments, you know, and I look at it's all a matter of where your priorities are. We as a country are falling behind the rest of the world because of our educational system.
Yeah.
And so if we can't compete with the rest of the world, mm-hmm. Jobs will become an issue across the board. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of look at some of these good work philanthropy. It's also good business, right? Mm-hmm. We want a thriving economy.
Sure.
We want to educate everyone so that we have great talented workers and IP. And so I think the interconnectedness of business, of government and the like. But I will say that politicians go where the votes are, mm-hmm. and organizing around causes still is a very, very important way to get action taken.
You said you don't like to be, you don't think of yourself necessarily as a mogul. That's not a term that I think is too far off. But, and so as a mogul, you sit here and you really sort of have an impact on the world today. You weren't always that mogul. You talked about walking through the streets with your mom raising money. And those streets you referred to were Brooklyn. This would be, if I can do my math, this would be late 1950s, early 1960s. Talk to us about that time.
Well, my parents grew up in a really poor ethnic neighborhood in Lowell, Massachusetts. When you came from Greece, like my family did, first generation, they weren't educated. They didn't speak the language, and they came to Lowell, Massachusetts to work the mills. Mm-hmm. And then my father went into the service, and then when he got out, he got a job as a waiter in New York and knew my mom, and they got married. And so I grew up and we rented an apartment in Brooklyn, New York. And my neighborhood was very reflective of present day America, I feel.
What do you mean when you say that?
It was African-American, Puerto Rican, Swedish, Chinese.
Okay.
And so I grew up in an environment that was diverse. So mm-hmm. that's what I knew,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And then my mom and dad worked, and so I would go to school, and then you'd get out of school at 3.
Yeah.
And at 6:30, parents would come home, so you had three and a half hours, and I would go to a park right across the street from school mm-hmm. and play sports.
Yeah.
And it was fascinating to watch a bunch of my friends who we played sports ball with, and they've all done okay, mm-hmm. yet 10 yards from where the courts were,
yeah.
some of my friends were drinking and smoking pot and moving mm-hmm. on to bad things.
Mm-hmm.
And it just taught me at a really young age that who you hang out with,
yeah.
the activity that you take, and the difference between success and failure in that case was 10 yards. If you stopped and hung out on the bench, mm-hmm. you had a high
you,
predilection.
Or you got high.
had a high predilection to not do well.
Yeah,
and if
yeah.
you, and I had friends in both sides. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, one of my friends was more influential. He'd always pull me to go play mm-hmm. sports. Mm-hmm. And he was a little bit older. He's a really good athlete. And we became good friends. And just that motion of pulling me this way
right.
changed my life. And mm-hmm. I see how it affected other people's lives. And so
at that point, what was your dream?
I had muddled aspirations. I didn't know anyone who went to college. Mm-hmm. I really didn't think of going to college.
You said muddled aspirations. You didn't, there wasn't, I almost mistook you to say you wanted to be a model.
No, muddled. I couldn't really articulate what was possible mm-hmm. because my frame of reference mm-hmm. was very narrow.
Yeah.
Because all of the friends that I had, their dads were firemen mm-hmm. or policemen or worked in restaurants mm-hmm. with my father. Mm-hmm. And so that was the frame of reference. Now, I was fortunate, to be straightforward, my best friend growing up died of a heroin overdose. Mm-hmm. And it scared my mother and father dramatically.
How old was?
16 years old. Mm-hmm. And so they ripped me out of Brooklyn, New York, and we moved back to Lowell, Massachusetts. Mm-hmm. And that was a real reckoning. I mean, I literally, it wasn't a discussion, it was, we're getting out of here. That was too close to home.
Did you attend the funeral?
Of course. His name was Anthony Paisano, Nene. And I mean, he was my next door neighbor. We'd sleepovers, walked to school together.
Yeah.
And it was just one summer where he moved from drinking wine to smoking pot to doing something he shouldn't have been doing.
Yeah.
And so we moved to Lowell, and now I was a stranger in a strange land.
Before we get to Lowell, I want to see if I can tap into your being at that funeral service, what you thought.
I was scared. I was so incredibly sad because it happened really fast.
Yeah.
And I couldn't explain to anybody how, you know, this kid who 3 years ago, you know, we'd go on vacations together could have ended up in that kind of situation. Mm. And you feel helplessness because it simply was who he started chumming around with.
Yeah.
And because it was such an overwhelming culture that was moving in, mm-hmm. The only way you could get out of it was, you know, when I look back, it was a radical departure.
Get away. Yeah.
Just to change the circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
And again, how serendipity and luck, the reason I ended up in Washington, D.C. was we were poor and I needed a job. I started mowing people's lawns and I mowed this guy's lawn. I bought a book on how to mow lawns. And I was fairly fastidious and how he did. And the guy whose lawn I mowed said to me one day, I'm really impressed with how hard you're working and what you're doing. What are your aspirations?
Yeah.
And he said, where do you want to go to college?
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I went to Georgetown.
Okay.
I never heard of Georgetown. Yeah. I knew nothing about it.
Mm-hmm.
He got me a application and I filled it out, and the first time I ever came to Washington, D.C., I took a Greyhound bus, I think it was like on 12th Street or wherever
that's
is.
That's right, 12th and New York
12th
Avenue.
12th and New York mm-hmm. Avenue, and took a cab to Georgetown, and there I was.
Yeah.
Again, stranger in a strange
and
land.
And what year was that?
73,
mm-hmm.
74, yeah. And Washington was a lot different than it is.
Very, very, very different.
In fact, I'll tell you an interesting vignette. I remember being in new student orientation, and they said, enjoy the campus.
This is as a freshman?
Sophomore. Yeah.
Okay.
Enjoy orientation, enjoy the city, but whatever you do, don't go past 10th Street.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter just graduated from Georgetown, and we went to her new student orientation, and during the conversation saying, you know, enjoy everything in the city and, you know, go down to Verizon Center and go to the Shakespeare Theater and the Portrait Gallery. It's like, wow, in one generation, the whole city changed and turned around, and it's a great, great city. And it's why Georgetown, George Washington, Howard University, they reputationally have moved up. It's not just because of what the schools are all about, but our city has dramatically changed for the better.
So when you went to Georgetown, what was your vision there? Who did you want to become? What did you want to become?
Well, again, like all students, you know, you're not sure, you're curious, you're trying different things. I ended up having a 77-year-old Jesuit priest as my mentor. And I remember when he was assigned to me thinking, boy, did I get the wrong end of the stick. What will I possibly have in common with Father Joseph Durkin? And, you know, short of my mom and dad, he was the most influential, important person in my life.
How so?
Well, I had to write a thesis at Georgetown, and I was lazy. And he kept pushing me, you know, at least go to the library, get a book, you know, just get started. And so I went to the library and I found the shortest, smallest book. And it was by Ernest Hemingway called Old Man in the Sea.
Yeah.
I remember picking it out in the first chapter. It was a good day, the sun was hot. And I read the book and I said to Father Durkin, I found an author, I liked the book, and he asked me what it was about, and I told him, and he said, go back and read it again. It's got a lot more meaning about spirit, about faith. And I read it again, and make a long story short, I decided to do something on Hemingway, and the way I wanted to prove a theory, Father Durkin said, we ought to use a computer. This is 1976. There was one computer on the entire campus of Georgetown.
Okay.
And for a 77-year-old man in 1976 to encourage me to use a computer to prove a theorem, I didn't really understand that importance. But when I graduated, I was kind of first in a generation that looked at computing as a tool.
You graduated what year?
77. And then my first job was with a computer company in Lowell. And then I started my first company in the computer field in 1981. And I look back that I was very random in my pursuits. I went to the library and took out a book, and a Jesuit priest told me to use a computer. And I ended up in America Online, and you know, now you say I'm a digital entrepreneur, all from a mentor who encouraged me, go to the library and read a book. And so reading is really, really important. And you know, I look back at my friend dying of an overdose, and think of my older friend who would pull me, you know, don't hang around there, let's go play ball. And just two actions by mentors, if you will, helped me to end up here. So I think that's why giving back, I saw the personal relevance and importance and kindness, and so I want to pay it back.
You started your company, you started your first computer company in 1981. What gave you any sense of confidence that you could start a computer company and make a living?
You know, I wish I could tell you. I know when I told my mother and father I was going to quit my job and start a company, they told me, absolutely not. Are you crazy?
That's right.
You're getting a salary.
Sure.
You have insurance.
That's right.
Why
That's
would
right.
you want to take all of this risk? I had started my first business on the campus of Georgetown University in 1976. It was the bicentennial summer, and I read in the Washington Post that 35 million tourists were going to come into the city, and I said to my roommate at the time, there's got to be something we can sell these people. And he said, well, you're ambitious, I'm lazy, you don't have any money, I've got some money, you come up with the idea, I'll fund it. Mm-hmm. We'll split everything 50-50.
Okay.
He was my first venture capital backer.
And his name was?
Lawrence Armour.
Okay.
And we started a snow cone business called Snoco Loco Inc.
Okay.
Be a patriot, eat a snow cone, red, white, and blue. And we innovated. I can honestly say I think we were the first people to introduce what today is called variable pricing.
Mm-hmm.
If the temperature was 0 to 80 degrees, it was 50 cents.
Right.
If it was 80 to 90 degrees, okay, it was a buck.
All right.
And over 90 degrees, we negotiated.
There you go.
And so I had, at an early age, this desire to make money. I worked in a shoe store on Wisconsin Avenue on weekends, and I worked on the Hill for a congressman who then became Senator Paul Tsongas. And so I just learned how to have like high energy, high bandwidth, and do lots of things.
Had you discovered girls seriously at this time?
You know, I was younger. I was always youngest kid in the class because I had skipped a grade.
Mm-hmm.
And when I came into college, I think I was 17, and most of the girls were 18, and they wanted to go out with 20-year-old
mm-hmm.
guys.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to tell you I made up for lost time when I graduated, but my college years honestly were spent at school, at work, starting companies, and utilizing all of my time.
Mm-hmm.
And I learned a very valuable lesson there, that there are lots of distractions and empty calories in life. Television.
Mm-hmm.
I don't watch a lot of television.
Mm-hmm.
Video games now. You know, I would talk to my children about saving the planet by killing aliens on your television is really not helping you or helping anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And
watching the Rock Newman show.
Rock Newman, okay, you can dedicate that hour a week to good work.
Yeah.
But if you're analytic about where you spend your time,
mm-hmm.
you can reclaim a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
And there's this old saying, you need something done, give it to the busiest person.
Yeah.
Because they know how to manage their bandwidth. And I was forced to do that in college, but that has situated me well to be able to do a lot of things because I don't waste a lot of time on.
I absolutely wanted to ask you the big piece. I thought it was a fabulous piece in the Sports Illustrated in December of 14. And you talked about big bandwidth and doing big things. Your focus is on really big things and really small things, and you leave stuff in the middle for others. Can you expound on that a little bit?
Yeah, I think big organization, or any organization, you always need to have the leadership focused on the strategy, the narrative, the culture, the higher calling, the partnerships. That's big stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then the little things are what really matter. At Verizon Center, when I walk around, I want to make sure, and you know, sometimes you get critiqued, you know, is the ketchup able to go into the holder?
Yeah.
Because if someone orders their hamburger and french fries and then waits in line
mm-hmm.
to get their ketchup and there's no ketchup,
mm-hmm.
they're disappointed.
That's a bad day.
It's a bad day.
Yeah.
And I try to explain to people that this individual spending a lot of time in line and spending a lot of money, and a little thing like ketchup might ruin that experience.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to worry about the big things. we want to win championships. We want to make the playoffs. We want to have great game day experience, but you got to have the ketchup.
Yeah.
The stuff in the middle is what the 2,000 full and part-time people get focused on. They should manage their departments. They should be given clear marching orders, but you should be grateful and thankful that you have talented people who follow what the big picture is and that they can execute.
Mm-hmm.
And I've tended not to micromanage the middle. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, these are the outcomes that we're looking for, and sure. as long as you're playing within the strategy and the culture and know what the outcomes are, I trust that you're going to do good work.
Mm-hmm. I've said to a number of my male guests that we have something in common, and I think you're no exception. I've said to them that they've married way over their heads, like I did.
Yes.
We have a we have some, what I'm being told, is world-class exclusive footage. Let's take a look.
I find that working out with my wife, who's side by side on the treadmills, it's a great way to spend a good quality hour every day with your wife, and I have found it to be very, very productive.
One of the best decisions you ever made?
Well, family is really, really important to all of us, and I'm no different, and I love my wife, and I love my kids, and, you know, as you get older, your health matters,
yes. right?
And I want to be around for a long, long time. I have good genes in my family. My dad passed away, he's 94 years old, and my wife wants me around, and so one of the things that we have been focused on the last 3 or 4 years is working out, and by doing that, we have something to do.
Yeah.
Together, we take our day off.
Did you, as someone who in a previous time had struggled with weight,
yep.
did you have a particular aha moment? If so, what was it?
You know, I did have one. Once a year, I go and get like an annual checkup, and I was being lulled into, I guess, a false sense of security, because my blood work was always good, everything was good, but my weight was continuing to go up. Mm-hmm. Now, it was interesting, my dad's physiognomy, he was very slight growing up, as was I, mm-hmm. and he put on weight, mm-hmm. and then he lost a lot of weight. Mm. But my moment was this doctor who takes care of me, I invited him to a hockey game.
Okay.
And he said, let's take a walk around in between periods. Mm-hmm. And as we were leaving the box, he said, let's walk around, 20,000 people here. Yeah. I want you to count how many 300-pound, 80-year-old men you see.
Mm.
That was like a really great soundbite, because
yeah.
you know what?
Yeah.
There's not a lot.
There weren't, yeah.
And so I just felt that it was time to get serious about
before you got serious. What was your Achilles heel?
I would say non-mindful eating, because I was always busy. Mm-hmm. You would never think about what you were going to eat, mm-hmm. What you were going to drink. Mm-hmm. So the science and work that you put into your real life wasn't transferring, so simple things like don't drink soda or beer or alcohol, drink water. Mm-hmm. I drink 72 ounces of water a day. Mm-hmm. That was hard to get to, but that's way healthier than empty calories. Mm-hmm. The other thing that was getting to me, and it still does at times, is the owner's box. Mm-hmm. You know, you sit around. In fact, I saw this the other day. We go into overtime against a team, and I look at my partners, and they're scooping up the M&Ms. And
plain peanut almond.
They had peanuts. Okay. And I grabbed carrots and celery now. Mm-hmm. And just in that moment of shoveling in those M&Ms, probably 1,000 calories, mm-hmm. And then the game ends, and you go home and go to bed.
Yeah.
I mean, it couldn't be a worse scripting
sure.
for your health. And mm-hmm. so I've just become, in all things, mindful. You know, I work out, and I drink a lot of water. I'm trying to get more sleep, mm-hmm. right? And so that means less reading at night or less television at night. And we all come to this as we get older. Mm-hmm. But I do think it's around this concept of just being mindful of what you're
How
doing.
How much has your recently found health regimen, what impact has it had on your productivity?
Well, the best thing about it is the reinforcing nature of it. So as you work out, so I try to do 10,000 steps a day and 20,000 steps on weekends. Mm-hmm. And as you lose weight, you ache less. Mm-hmm. So that allows you to work harder and faster, so you get more results. Mm-hmm. And your recovery time is that much better. So I found that was self-registering, mm-hmm. and very, very positive. I would say I have more energy, and having more energy allows you to do things as you sleep more. So last night I went to bed with my wife at about 9 o'clock. Mm-hmm. We talked, we watched a little TV. I was sleeping at 10. I was up at 5 this morning. I did like 3 hours worth of work. I joked to my wife, I said, I probably got more done from 5 to 8 than mm-hmm. many people do mm-hmm. during the day. Mm-hmm. And then I made a phone call on my way to the board meeting, and then I was at this charitable foundation from 9 o'clock till 2:30, and now I'm here.
Ted, walk us through. You started this company, this computer company, up in Lowell, Massachusetts. And walk us through the various phases that brought you into Washington, D.C., and, you know, sitting on the perch which you now occupy.
Well, again, I would trace it all back to Georgetown and Father Durkin and this work I did early on with computers. And then my first job was with a populist computer company called the Wang Laboratories. Mm-hmm. And Wang was very special. It's no longer in existence, but it was very special because it was aimed at women who were entering the workforce. Mm-hmm. You know, we forget how time marches on, but it wasn't until the 70s that two-wage earner households and women were really flocking, graduating from college and flocking into the workforce. And the first jobs that many women were given were administrative mm-hmm. work. Mm-hmm. And they were typewriters and stuff. Yeah. So Wang created this application that automated typing, filing, almost early on created email. Mm-hmm. And their email systems were, you know, within their own network. Mm-hmm. And so I saw through my work at Georgetown and then at Wang that there was this relentless march to social acceptance of technology. Mm-hmm. And while I was at Wang, I went to a trade show. I met Steve Jobs in 1979, and I bought an Apple II computer. Mm-hmm. And doing that was a great investment because I spent the money and now I had this personal computer and I had to learn stuff to do with it. Mm-hmm. And again, so rather than watching TV or going to bars, mm-hmm. right, and chasing girls, I would spend a little bit more time, what is this? Mm-hmm. And then again, inspiration, serendipity, I went grocery shopping. I was a bachelor, and at the checkout line, I saw a TV guide. Remember the old TV Guide magazine?
Absolutely, yeah.
And the TV Guide, there was the Starburst, said the number one best-selling magazine in America, which shocked me because I'd never seen one because mm-hmm. we didn't watch a lot of TV in my house.
Okay.
And I bought the magazine, and I took it home, and I looked at it, and the front of the magazine was interviews with television stars and directors, and the back of the book was a directory, what program worked on what network. Hmm. I threw it away.
Sure.
And then I went into my home office, and I sat in front of my Apple II computer, and I went, oh my gosh, this looks like a television.
Yeah.
It's just a piece of glass, mm-hmm. and TV Guide talks about programs, mm-hmm. and I had 3 software programs, and mm-hmm. TV Guide talks about networks,
yeah.
ABC, NBC, CBS. Mm-hmm. And at the West Coast Computer Fair, they were talking about Ethernet networks, this mm-hmm. way that you connected computers. And I honestly had this whack on the side of the head mm-hmm. saying, I bet you won't be able to tell the difference between computers and televisions and networks, and this will all come together. Mm-hmm. And that inspired me to start my first company, which was a a guide, if you will. 1981, IBM just introduced the PC. I was very young. I raised a little bit of venture capital and hustled to create, if you will, the TV guide for the personal computer industry. Mm-hmm. And that company grew really, really fast.
When you did that in the early stages, was your head just down working at perfecting this idea? Or were there visions dancing in your head of hundreds of millions of dollars in the future?
No, in fact, I can say sincerely it was make this the best product possible, mm-hmm. and that the journey would be the reward. We sold the company, mm-hmm. and at a very young age I made a lot of money,
yeah.
but that was not the goal. I didn't go into it as that is the outcome. Mm-hmm. I honestly think that now today that I'm an investor, when I meet young people and, you know, what's your goal? I want to take a company public and make $1 billion.
Yeah.
Kind of walk away from them. That's a not managed outcome. You want to make mm-hmm. something that you're proud of, that's differentiated, the customers love, you want to create jobs for people. And you know, I call it double bottom line. I think mm-hmm. companies that do best have some kind of double bottom line mm-hmm. around them. They're going to do really well, mm-hmm. and they're doing good or some good. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a great example. I was one of the first investors, and I'm now chairman of a company called Groupon.
Yes.
And there was a time period, a year or so ago, I stepped in for a short period of time to be co-CEO. Mm-hmm. And Groupon was started by an entrepreneur to help small businesses compete with big businesses and help millennials who were struggling to get jobs to have experiences and be able mm-hmm. to eat out and save money.
Yeah.
So there was an innate goodness around it, even though people say, it's a couponing business. Yeah. No, there was something fundamental. Banks stopped loaning money to small businesses,
yeah.
right?
Yeah.
They stopped loaning money. They couldn't get factoring. And here would come Groupon, and we'd sell 1,000 coupons for $50. Mm-hmm. And we would give the money to the store, to the retailer, right up front.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
We were trusting them to stay in business because we stood behind mm-hmm. if they went out of business, mm-hmm. we had to make good to the consumer.
Right.
That was called the Groupon guarantee. And it was, wow, we are helping all of these small businesses. And oh, by the way, young people are struggling, they're not owning homes, they're renting, they're not buying cars,
yeah.
they're eating out more and more, they want experiences. So if we can offer them trial something, go mm-hmm. eat at half price. And so the company grew like crazy. It's now got 12,000 employees and it's a big company.
My viewing audience will call for my head. This time has gone with like warp speed. We've got about 7 minutes left.
Oh, wow. Okay.
We've got to talk about your being at AOL and then you're getting into this Washington, D.C. sports world.
Well, AOL was a great company, growing really, really fast. And the second company that I started was acquired by AOL. And I was fortunate that we were early on in the new media online world. And I became president of the main service. And the company grew really fast. Mm-hmm. And I had a lot of stock. And in 1999, the opportunity to buy the Washington Capitals and a minority piece of what was then called Washington Sports and Entertainment from Abe and Irene Poland and their family presented itself.
Yeah.
And so I bought 100% of the Caps and then 44% at the time of Verizon Center, MCI back then, I guess, and the Wizards and the like.
Did you ever consider that was a risk?
Yes, of course it's a risk, but again, I did think, and I still think, it's a double bottom line mm-hmm. business. I saw firsthand what the building was doing for the community.
Mm-hmm.
Abe and Irene and the family took great risk in situating that building where it was,
yeah.
took on a lot of debt. Mm-hmm. I've since stepped in those shoes. I know how much money we pay in mortgage and in principal, and that community expanded dramatically, mm-hmm. and the tax base generated from that has really helped our city.
Yeah.
And then the teams, to be able to create a lifelong memory and give back to the community. Two nights ago at a Wizards game, we beat Portland, and that yeah. was terrific. And mm-hmm. at the end of the game, there was a young man who was there with his father in a wheelchair who has level 4 cancer. Mm. It was really tough to see this beautiful young kid. And I told him, I said, if we win, I'll sneak us into the locker room. Mm-hmm. And so we win, and I take him and his dad into the locker room, and there's John Wall, and I whisper to John Wall, and John jumps up and takes his brand new sneakers and signs the sneakers and gets him his game-worn jersey and signs it. And I bring him to Paul Pierce, and Paul Pierce, can I get my picture with you? And Paul Pierce says, John gave you his sneakers? I'm going to be in the Hall of Fame. I'm giving you my sneakers. Yeah. And to watch our players go from it's about the game and the competition to this is a memory that this family and this young boy will take forever. And as he was leaving, I gave him a hug. I mean, the sneakers are this big.
Yeah.
And he said to his dad, I can't wait to grow up so I can wear these. And it was, man, I mean, that I couldn't have scripted something better that this young boy left feeling happy.
Yeah.
And going to fight, right? And his father was very grateful for how quickly the players went from celebrating the victory mm-hmm. to being focused on this young man. And mm-hmm. and to own an enterprise, or you know, be involved with an enterprise that can do well. Hey, we're selling a lot of tickets. Yeah. Hey, you know, we're going to get good TV deals. Yeah. Hey, yeah. we're going to make the playoffs. Mm-hmm. Hopefully one day we're going to win a championship. That's fantastic. Mm-hmm. But to have this positive impact on your community economically, but then emotionally, mm-hmm. I think it's the greatest business in the world.
You were stung by Washington, D.C., not continuing to be in the running for the 24 Olympics. Why was that so meaningful for you?
Well, I think it's the greatest city on earth.
Yeah.
And obviously we failed in communicating that. And I also thought that there was an important agenda that government city planning, they work on their own pace and they tend sometimes to spend time, effort, and money where votes are. Mm-hmm. And we have 3 or 4 neighborhoods that we need to create jobs, we need to create infrastructure, we need to pull them up. We have a dirty river. The Potomac River defines our community. The Anacostia River has been neglected.
Yeah.
And so I just felt if we could bring the Olympics and situate a lot of things on the Anacostia, then we'd have to clean up the Anacostia. We'd have to build infrastructure there. There was a proxy for that in London. I went to London twice. Mm-hmm. I walked around. The Olympic Village got turned into the most dynamic, best low-income housing in London. Mm-hmm. A neglected community
yeah.
got public transportation. Mm-hmm. It's now connected, mm-hmm. and there is great high-quality, low-income housing. The investment in the data center and the business center and the media center, that got repurposed and is now the venture capital hub for London.
Yeah.
And so this community that was you drove around it mm-hmm. in London became central.
Mm-hmm.
And I just thought, what a great opportunity for us that we can reintroduce Washington, because I think we're misunderstood to the world. No brand gets transmitted more around the world than the Olympics. And two, while we're doing that, we could have positive social, economic impact on some of these communities. And we failed in it. And so, yeah, I feel bad that I wasn't good enough, if you will, to convince the USOC and then the IOC that Washington deserved the games.
Might there be a shot in the future? We've got about 30 seconds left.
I think maybe a next generation of person, you know, this was for the 2024 Olympics, right? I guess there'd be for the 2028 Olympics. Our generation, you know, I'm getting older, and so I hope that there's somebody in the community that sees it the same way and goes again, because just because you failed once doesn't mean you're going to fail on an ongoing basis, and I would encourage someone to pick up that mantle.
Ted, you have to help me not fail on this statement right here, that this has to be part one of what is going to be part two. We're done, and there's so much more to talk about.
Well,
I've got to have you back.
Appreciate it. You're looking great, too,
by
the way.
Thank you so much. Thanks for joining us. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time around.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.